sponsored by PokerStars.com.
The greatest names in poker have hot-footed it straight from Vegas to kickstart their winter season.
EPT5, baby.
Big names and big money are the talk of the town in Barcelona as the European Poker Tour returns. Ladies and gents, welcome to Barcelona, venue for the first European Poker Tour showdown of Season 5.
The European Poker Tour is back, and what better place to kick the tour off in style than here in beautiful Barcelona. With ever-increasing fields, bigger prize pools, and some exciting new venues, Season 5 of the EPT promises to be the best yet.
EPT, Season 5, baby.
This is the fifth visit the tour has made to Barcelona, and the figures are larger than ever. 619 players entered, creating a healthy 4.9 million euro prize pool. The top 64 get paid, with first place taking home a monstrous 1.36 million euros, the fourth biggest EPT payday. It's day three, and 36 players remain, including Season 4 San Remo champion, Jason Mercier.
25% of the guys are going to be at the final table, so, you know, looking forward to it. Hope I can make my second EPT final table.
Definitely a force to be reckoned with.
Jason Mercier is a really, really good player, and he's really aggressive. If he gets position on me, I guess I have to make a stand at some point.
Jonas hoping to better that 12th place San Remo finish, while recent WSOP bracelet winner Sebastian Ruthenberg is also a serious contender for the title. And American pro Chad Brown has his own game plan.
Only 36 players left, so you have to really try to dissect where the players are at, not take anything for granted.
But the man in the driving seat right now is tourney chip leader Davide Kitaj of Belgium. It's time to get over to our first feature table.
How exciting is this? The start of the fifth season of the EPT. Oh, I'm all of a quiver. I'm James Hartigan. Alongside me is Greg Raymer, the man who took down the 2004 World Series of Poker main events. Some big names at this table, Greg.
Absolutely, James. We just saw Chad Brown. He is one of the top American players. Several major final tables, lots of experience. Really more important than anything else, he spent years kicking butt in the cash games, the high-stakes cash games in Vegas and California.
And here is an EPT champion, Jason Mercier, raising it up with ace king.
Jason, open support.
Blinds currently 3,000 and 6,000. Jason makes it 16 and a half. This is Daniela Mazzia from Italy. He'll fold. Chad Brown capping his cards. Oh, that's why. Pocket sevens.
And Chad is calling.
Calling in position. Is that why he's not re-raising, Jason?
Well, and also, I mean, pocket sevens isn't that great of a hand. What he doesn't want to do is turn it into a bluff. If he re-raises there and Jason shoves in, he won't be able to call. But now he can try to see the flop, flop a set, you know, and try to double up as a huge favorite.
Interest in the small blind from this guy. This is Jose Vasquez Ortega. He's a local boy. A lot of support for him in the stands.
Yeah, but he's in a bad spot. He doesn't know it, and there's really no problem with him coming in here with 7-6 of diamonds. I mean, that's generally a playable hand as long as your stack is deep enough.
And Vasquez calls.
But the real question here is his stack deep enough? He doesn't have a lot of chips, and he's got this speculative hand. He might be better off having folded it.
This is Mikael Lundell. And the Swedish player's got money invested in the big blind. He's got a small pair. He's going to peel off the flop and hope to hit a set. And Jason's thinking, I didn't really want three callers there.
Well, still, he has, you know, basically the best hand at this point in time, as you can see by the percentages. I mean, even though he can't beat the pair of fives or the pair of sevens at the moment, he's got the most pot equity.
Queen of hearts, king of clubs.
And he's hit his king.
And now his pot equity is going to skyrocket. He basically only has to worry about someone hitting a seven, a five. Well, we got running clubs for Chad Brown, running straight possibilities for Ortega. But basically, there's only three cards in the deck that can beat him by themselves.
Well, Ortega and Lundell have checked to the raiser. And Jason's going to make the continuation bet with the best hand.
Yeah, and this should just be three folds. No one has a hand that can continue on this flop. At least not intelligently continue.
It's not the flop that Chad Brown wanted. Three overcards to his sevens.
Exactly. And that's, you know, Chad had no intention of doing anything else, and I doubt that Lundell had any other intentions. Flop a set or get out of the way.
Didn't expect three calls.
Yeah.
It's all go here in Barcelona. We're already down to 34 players sat at five tables. Table two is now six-handed, and four of them are Italian. In fact, so are eight of the remaining 34, indicative indeed of the sport's growing stature in Italy. Table four features many people's favorite to take the title here in Barcelona, the up-and-coming Sebastian Ruthenberg. And last but not least, our TV table, where Sweden's Mikael Lundell needs to get busy and is all in against Chad Brown.
And Lundell must have thought that Chad was trying to steal this one, pushing with Queen 8, but Chad was raising with a legitimate hand, and he's called the all-in with the pocket jacks.
Well, it seems to me like Lundell made a mistake here, because after Chad raised to 17,000, Lundell pushes in for 47,000. He should expect to get called pretty often and pretty late.
Oh, but what a flop for him.
Well, sometimes bad play gets rewarded.
Unbelievable.
Let's see the turn.
Chad now drawing thin. Needs to hit one of the two remaining jacks in the deck on the river, or he's going to be sending a huge chunk of chips over to Mikael Lundell. And that's what's going to happen.
Well, I mean, you know, he was certainly the favorite pre-flop, but it's not like he was an overwhelming favorite with his pocket jacks. But he usually is going to lose by Lundell hitting a queen, not two eights.
Yeah, normally it's the overcard that you're worried about. But we've seen it before, and you know what, Greg? I think we're going to see it again. And Chad's not going to stew on it.
Sponsored by PokerStars.com.
The blinds in Barcelona, still 3,000, 6,000. Every player posting the ante of 500.
Well, we'll see if Chad is still stewing over his unlucky run-in with the Queen 8.
What is it with jacks? You can fold them, you can raise with them, you can call with them. Every single way of playing them seems to be wrong.
Well, you're not supposed to fold them very often, at least pre-flop.
Daniele raised to 16.
The button raised from Daniele Mazzia, the Italian, pushing it up with king-queen offsuit. Here's Chad in the small blind. He's got the jacks again!
Well, we know what he should do here. Re-raise is definitely the correct. I mean, he's got a button raise here. He's got the best hand probably 98% of the time right now. You know, not knowing his opponent.
Chad re-raised to 45,000.
All right, that's a good play.
Alexander Grishuk in the big blind. Looks down at king. Ah, oh, it's a six. Just hoping that it's going to be another king. Or at least an ace.
Well, that's actually good news for Chad, though. He doesn't know it because one of his opponent's kings is dead.
Matsya's not going to call here, is he?
Looks like he's going to raise back.
Re-raise to 116,000. All in. And re-raise on in.
Chad moves all in, and Mazzia must be committed to this pot by now.
Well, yeah, he just made it 100 and, what are we here, 116,000, and now it's 174,000 total. So,
yeah, 58,000.
He is pot committed here, 58,000 more. The only thing Chad might have done differently here is he might have tried the stop and go play. He might have just flat called and then bet the flop, no matter what came, and see if he could get his opponent to lay down at that point for 58,000 more, but even then, probably not.
The question is, are you surprised that Mazzia re-raised Chad's re-raise?
Well, he must... Either he's making a really bad play with the king-queen, or he has reason to believe that Chad is messing around for some reason. But Chad doesn't mess around very often.
No.
So I can't believe that Chad's image at this point Chad's in time is loose.
Well, he calls the 58,000. The cards go on their back, and Mazzia sees that he's actually got a coin flip against Chad Brown. Better position than a queen-eight would be.
Well, 57-43, I don't think these statistics take into account the dead king that we saw in the big blind. So he's actually a bigger favorite right now, Chad, is than 57%.
But there's the queen on the flop.
It doesn't matter.
I'm telling you, Chad, you got to stop playing those jacks, buddy. They never work.
Well, you know, the interesting thing is the better player you are, the more unlucky you're going to be. Because when you're a better player, you don't get your money in bad. You can't get lucky. You can only get unlucky.
Ten or a jack on the river for Chad Brown to survive. His tournament's on the line here.
It's a four.
It's a blank on the river.
Give a nice round of applause, please, for Chad Brown.
Chad's been eliminated, Greg.
34 place finisher.
So Chad's a great player, so, you know, that's the thing you always like to say, especially when you get unlucky, you tell yourself, look, it, you know, a great player only gets unlucky. We never get lucky. Because unless it's a cold deck situation, we never get our money in bad.
And Chad was followed off the TV table by Russia's Alexander Grischuk in 33rd, leaving us with 32. And now, with Chad's chips, Mattia is second, but leading the field is the Belgian Davide Kataj, who finished 11th in Barcelona last year.
Action continues on our featured table. Seven-handed at the moment. A couple of new players. I'll introduce them in a moment. Action is going to be on Jose Ortega. Queen 7 off suit. That will go in the muck.
It certainly should.
Vasquez pass, Michael pass.
But, you know, we've seen Queen 8 get creative. Why not Queen 7?
I only saw one of Jason Mercier's cards there. Oh, two sixes. I only saw the first one.
Jason raised to 16-5.
Jason's one of the biggest stacks at the table, and any pair he's going to be playing, for sure, at this stage of the tournament.
So this is Malte Strothmann from Germany. Just joined the table. King Jack off suit. This is what I call a danger hand, Greg.
Well, we don't call it a danger hand. We call it a fool's hand, because this is the kind of hand that really gets people in trouble.
I was being polite.
Yeah, well, the thing is, you know, these things like this, weak aces, weak kings, they can get you in so much trouble because you flop top pair and you end up playing a big pot and it's always someone with a bigger kicker.
Joe Pelton folded the small blind. Now the English player, Stephen Chidick, with the same hand as Jason Mercier will call that raise.
Well, King Jack, as you can see, is the big favorite now just because he happens to be against the same two underpairs. Neither of them can hit a set to make three of a kind and knock him out of the running.
And the flop is King of Diamonds.
Well, and then he's not going to go anywhere now that he's hit top pair.
Check, check.
Jason checked.
Look at those numbers, 0% already.
Action on my 10.
I imagine that a bet from Strothman's going to do it.
Most likely. Someone might try to get creative here and put him on a bluff since he only called the raise. They might say he doesn't have to have an 8 or a king here. He could just be betting his position. The funny thing is, if Jason were to check raise right now, Strothmann would really be in a tough spot because he would know he's either way ahead or way behind.
Jason passed.
Jason waits for a better opportunity.
Well, the King Jack is going to work out for him this time. But see, the problem there is if he had ended up getting re-raised or if he'd gotten action, it more frequently would have been something like Ace King or King Queen.
Well, we've got action on the outer tables. Alessandro Longobardi is all in, flipping over his hand, which is Queen Queen. He's up against Jonas Melander with pocket kings. There's a queen on the flop. He's made trips. Doesn't look very happy about it, does he?
No, he doesn't. He should, though.
The river card is a five. Full house, queens full of fives.
He was just being patient. He was waiting to make sure he had won before he started cheering. So that's very professional of him.
Not sure about that shirt.
I think it's better than yours, mate.
The day is drawing to an end here in Barcelona, but there's no sign of the action slowing down inside. 30 players of the original field of 619 remain, and of those eliminated, well, some of them have stuck around. Team PokerStars Pro Luca Pagano, how was your EPT Barcelona?
I went out very soon this tournament. I went out at the fifth or the sixth level. I mean, it happens. I mean, sometimes the cards doesn't help. I don't think that I played my best game. I mean, the season is still very long, so we are going to have plenty of opportunities to try to improve our records, which is something that I really care.
Well, of course, and, you know, to add to your record, Player of the Year for the EPT Season 4, so congratulations on that. That must feel quite good.
Thank you very much, Cara. I mean, I'm very honored to get to have this kind of awards, and I'm really looking forward to get also a very good result during this season. I want to prove that award means something for me.
Well, let's see who proves it here today at EPT Barcelona, and we're going to go straight back to the action.
Vasquez pass, Michael pass.
Hold it around to Jason Mercier on the button. Look at those towers of chips.
Well, this is definitely a spot where Jason's going to be opening pretty wide. In other words, he's going to be raising with a lot of hands. He's got a big stack of chips. He's got the button. He's not a timid player.
Yeah, I should remind you that the purples are 500, the reds are 1,000, the yellows 5,000.
And he's going to get some heat for sure here.
Ace King for Malte Strothman.
Yeah, I don't think there's any player who can make it this far in the tournament and be tight enough to throw away Ace King in this spot.
How to play it? Do you re-raise, flat call, see a flop?
This is where you really can mix it up and where different players are going to play differently. Some people are going to flat call because then if they hit their ace or king, their opponent may not give them credit for that card. And they might re-raise like this because that way now if I miss the flop, I don't have to worry about misplaying the hand.
Count.
Jason wants a count.
It's too much, Jason. He'll figure that out momentarily, though. Jason's too good a player to call here for this much more. I mean, he's not even getting 3-2 on the call, so he's never going to call with Jack High.
Shoving so light here, that's the thing.
Well, that's Jason acknowledging that you know how light I am, that I can have any two cards maybe. So you might be re-raising me with almost any two cards. But he's still not going to call here with Jack 9 getting this price.
Sure enough,
we'll
fold the hand.
It up,
so another pot for Malte Strothman.
No better than ace
10. Trying to engage him in conversation.
Oh, king.
He's trying to get him to show.
No way that's an ace. Yeah.
I have an ace.
Huh?
I have an ace.
You had an ace?
Yeah.
I was actually hoping you were going to just call. I have a good hand to play. But not to call his all hand.
That's pretty much giving the hand away right there. suited connectors, suited one gappers, offsuit connectors, that kind of hand.
Strothman cracks a smile.
Well, this could be an important part of being a good poker player, is you engage in this discussion in between hands because you can learn how your opponent is playing. You can talk him into showing his cards like that so that you can figure him out.
Now, in this hand, we're going to do something very exciting, Greg. Anyone can be an expert when you can see all the cards, but here, we're only going to see Jason Mercier's whole cards. So we're going to have to play it from his perspective and try and gather the information from the other player, from their betting patterns, from their behavior, to see what they're holding.
And this is what real poker is. I mean, a lot of people watch these shows on TV, and even some of the commentators, I know in America we have some commentators who make ridiculous statements, but it's because they know all the cards.
Daniele Pass.
So I won't mention names, and that way they won't come in my, you know, break into my bedroom in the middle of the night with a gun.
So we've seen Jason raise in late position. I think he was in the cutoff seat. Ace deuce off suit. And it's his nemesis, Malte Strothman, in the small blind here.
Yeah. So we know what Malte Strothman's capable of. You know, we know how he might play an ace king, but you know, the fact that he would do something different doesn't mean he doesn't have ace king again.
Well, he's folded here.
So this is the difficulty.
Joe Pelton in the big blind. And Jason's going to get action.
Big blind call. Two black players. Call.
And with Jason's reputation, it's, you know, if Pelton thinks he's raising light again, he can call with a wide range of hands here.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, right now, we really can put Pelton on just any two cards. He might have called with total garbage hand, just trying to outplay Jason after the flop. He might be trapping with a monster.
Well, it goes check, check on the flop. Jason makes a straight on the turn.
Well, see, now, at this point, if you're Jason, you don't really care what Joe has. No matter what Pelton has, you're just trying to think, how do I get all the money in? And if he happens to have, like, the 6-7, oh, well, I'm just going to double him up. So at this point, reading his hand is almost insignificant, except that if you read him for strength right now, you'll play it fast and raise right now. If you think he's really, really weak, you flat call to give him another chance to bluff the river.
That's what he's done. Pelton made the bet of 30,000. Jason calls it. The river brings
a six.
Well, that's not the worst card for Jason to see. The spade would have been the worst. Because it's most likely to beat him, and it's most likely to scare Pelton away from bluffing anymore.
Well, it'll be just Jason's luck that he's sitting there with pocket sevens.
Well, then that would just be a bad beat, and oh well. You know, I got lucky against him on the turn, he got lucky on the river. It happens all the time. But with four to a straight on the board, this is, he can't raise. Even though he knows he probably has the best hand, he can't raise.
Call. 9 queen to hand for Chilzev.
That's bad luck.
His queen high.
9 queen, he had absolutely nothing. He was just trying to bluff, and that's why Jason just called the turn for this kind of hand. Bad river, he said. Yep. He can't raise now. If it's
exactly.
A queen would have been perfect in hindsight, because then he can raise and get called, maybe.
All he can do in that situation is flat call and hope your straight's good. No, good turn.
Well, I'm really impressed with how Jason played the hand. I think he played it brilliantly.
Either way, even if he hits a queen, he's not paying off a raise and win. Probably not.
So Jason becoming a familiar face on the EPT, having taken down San Remo last season. Tournament winnings of close to €1 million. His favorite team, the Cincinnati Bengals, not having a great 2008 season, it has to be said. He used to be a maths teacher, he likes snowboarding, and his favorite poker player is Antonio Esfandiari, the magician. And it's great to watch Jason play. A very methodical, very thoughtful player.
Yeah, I mean, Jason really is a good example of the new breed of talented poker player, in that he, you know, has exceptional understanding of the basic concepts, of the correct strategies of no-limit hold'em tournament play. But it's the new players aren't as known for their vibrant personalities as the old guard. You know, the kind of stuff that you would see from, like, an Antonio Esfandiari at the table, the kind of chatter that you get from
the
Phil Locke, you know, and a Daniel Negreanu and so forth.
Joseph pass, Stephen pass, Vasquez pass.
Quickly folded around the
Michael
table
pass.
To the small blind, the aforementioned Jason Mercier.
Jason
flat calls with the Queen Jack, and okay. Daniela Mazzia will check
friendly,
his option.
Poker over
it's a friendly
no,
game.
Well, Queen Jack was a pretty good hand, especially blind versus blind, but out of position, Jason just electing to flat call, which is a very reasonable option.
Jason check, and
that's your betting with absolutely nothing.
Yep, no hand and no draw. Jason sees through it.
Call.
Calling with queen high, which is the best hand.
Turn cards, king.
It's getting harder and harder to call with
Jason
queen high.
Checks, Daniela checks. River card, four.
He's hit a four on the river.
Both check, showdown.
They check it down, and Mattia says,
I see pair of fours for Daniela.
I got lucky on the river.
That's the only card.
You call me Queen Eye.
Ten, you don't win.
Queen check, which is not enough. Pot goes to.
Well, it's unlucky, but this is a small pot, and neither player had much of a hand. So, you know, this is not the kind of bad beat you're going to stew over for any length of time.
No, if you're going to lose a pot, lose the small ones.
Sponsored by PokerStars.com.
Night falls in Barcelona, host city to the opening event of Season 5 of the PokerStars.com European Poker Tour, where there is still €4.4 million to be divided up between the remaining 28 players.
Blinds are up. We're now playing 4,000, 8,000 with a running ante of 1,000. And action's going to be on Mikael Lundell. Swedish player looking down at a queen and a king. King, queen.
Well, let's see how our lucky Swede is doing now. It's been a while, though, since he got lucky with the queen eight. We can't keep teasing him about it. Well, actually, I can, but I shouldn't.
Michael Cole, 8,000.
Find me a player who won a tournament without getting lucky.
Yeah, but sometimes you get lucky when you were supposed to be there anyways. In other words, you were supposed to lose to a cold deck and then you got lucky instead.
Mercia and Mattia both fold with 9-4 off suit. I think Strothman's going to follow their example. I think he's going to follow their example.
Well, he should be following their example, and And since he should be, why is he taking so much time sweating over the 9-4?
Ace deuce on the button. Pass. Pelton passes.
Well, maybe he just sensed Lundell didn't have a big, big hand and he was small thinking of making point. A move.
Big blind check.
Steve Chittick calling from the small blind. Ortega checking his option with the deuces.
And the flop is five of spades, king of clubs, tray of diamonds.
Oh, Chittick could get into trouble here, couldn't he?
He checks.
Oh, he certainly could. And, you know, actually, it's kind of interesting that Lundell didn't come in with a raise. I mean, normally you would raise coming first in at this stage of a tournament. Any hand you're going to play, you would come in for a raise. But he might get paid off for his deviation from standard practice here.
Michael bets 25,000.
Made it 25,000. It's a decent size bet.
Yeah, he's betting almost the pot, a little less than the pot size bet there. I'm not sure I liked his acting job, though. It you know, it seemed too deliberate.
Yeah. The way he's sitting there shaking his head, it's not too convincing. Is he going to get action from Chittick?
Well, if I'm Chidwick, I'm never just folding at this point in this hand.
Stephen calls.
I mean, we've checked to the guy who limped in, who could have almost any kind of hand. He could have limped in strong. He could have pocket aces, pocket kings. Could have him absolutely crushed, but he doesn't have to have anything. He quite frequently would have limped in with hands like 7-8 of hearts. And this flop has completely missed him. But if the blinds are willing to check, he'll take a stab at it.
Well, Tega takes a while to fold. I don't think he had any other move, quite frankly.
Well, now Chidwick's picked up the gutshot straight draw, so he knows that even if he was drawing dead, so to speak, now he can catch a six and win the hand.
Michael bets all in.
Win the quick all in, too. Caveman style, I call that. Kind of grunt it. All in.
Cool.
And Chidwick calls.
Michael all in, showdown. Michael shows
not
king.
Not the
queen.
Best call I've ever seen.
Well, I don't think it's so bad, really, because basically there's, I think, an excellent chance that Lundell's bluffing in this spot, and that's where he can beat all bluffs. And even if he's not against the bluff, he has outs here. He has seven outs against this hand. Any six, any seven, and he's going to take this pot away anyways.
No seven.
And it's a queen.
Yes. Two pairs on the river for Lundell. He'll double up here.
Well, Chidwick handling it very professionally. You got to give him that.
Yeah, you tried to defend that call, Greg, but I don't think it's going to be appearing on this list anytime soon. As we celebrate five seasons of the EPT with a trawl through the archives, and remember the top five calls.
Five. Call it instinct, call it a sixth sense, or just call it and see what happens. There's a fine line between looking like a genius and a fool at the poker table. Not many flops look great with a pair of threes in your hand, especially when Vicky Corrin has set you all in following a pre-flop raise. Heroically though, with his tournament life on the line, Jan Savic deliberated for a whole 10 minutes before announcing those hallowed words.
And he's made the call, and it's a great call.
That's a great call.
And Vicky acknowledges that she is behind here.
Oh my word. Oh, poor old Jan.
And even Vicky is disgusted by that hand.
Oh. Most poker literature will tell you that a weak ace is no good against a raise. I'm guessing Johnson isn't a big fan of reading books. After a Van Wyck bet and a Johnson call on the flop,
well, I'm not sure if he knows where he is.
Johnson checks the turn and faces an all-in bluff from the aggressive Van Wyck.
And there's no way that Johnson can call this.
3.4 seconds later...
He's called it!
Oh, that's incredible. I got that wrong. That's an extraordinary call.
I suppose when you know, you just know. Bit like love, I guess. Sometimes, in a heads-up situation, a high card is enough to take down the pot. Internet whiz kid Carl Olson reached the river with just king high and faced a huge bluff from fellow American Brandon Schaefer. 270,000 chips gave Carl plenty to think about, but Carl smelt a rat.
Ultimately very hard to call. He's called it. That's, for me, the hand of the European poker tour.
You should know better than to mess with an internet pro. Brandon caught with his pants down.
Two.
Aggressive American Greg Dyer bet out strongly on the flop, the turn, and after missing his draw on the river, he fired out one last 330,000 chip bluff. Big bet from Greg Dyer. But Sander wasn't having any of it. No way, Jose.
call.
Are those x-ray specs, Mr. Lilov?
Seasons call. Showdown.
2 hours later, the Dane was champion. Well, what can I say about this one? Watch and learn. Eventual champion Jason Mercier found himself facing the erratic Frenchman Eric Koskos in a moment that would define both players' tournaments. Koskos had already bet big on the turn with just 10 high, and American Mercier made the call.
I'm all in.
Eric, all in.
The river came, and Eric's 700,000 all in gave Jason a huge decision. Was his bottom pair still good?
I call.
What a great call.
He's made the call, and Koskos will show he had absolutely nothing.
The kind of play which reminds us exactly why poker is such a beautiful game.
Really wonderful.
And back at our featured table, we've just lost another player. Joseph Pelton just taken out by Daniele Mazzia. You can see him just stacking up his hard-won chips there. And we're down to 26 players. Let's take a look, though, at our top eight. That hand has put Mazzia at the top of our leaderboard with 640,000 in chips. Jason Mercier has also moved up, though. He's now in third place, but dropping down to fourth, former chip leader Davide Katai.
And there's the man with the most chips right now, the Italian player Daniele Mazzia. A lot of Italians coming to this event, actually, Greg. I guess it's not far for them to travel.
A lot of Italians come to all the events now. I mean, poker is just expanding. It used to be Americans mostly, and then the British got into it, and continental Europe, France, and Sweden and Norway, the Scandinavian countries, and now everywhere. You know, we're expanding it all over the world, South America, Asia. It just keeps getting bigger and bigger. I love it.
One of the North American players, Jason Mercier, raising here to 21,500. He's got ace-six suited. Malte Strothman is sitting on the button.
Despite what we're showing you in the program, I do promise you that Jason is not actually raising every single hand in this tournament. It just seems that way. He seems to get involved in all of our more interesting hands.
Just every other hand.
Steven, re-raise all in.
Steve Chidick re-raising all in with the ace-queen.
And that sounds like a really good play to me here because given his chip count, you know, that's just the right way to play the hand. If he makes a smaller raise, he's making it too easy to get outplayed potentially if Jason flat calls him. He's got enough chips to make Jason fold, but not enough chips to play it any other way and do it intelligently. And ace-queen just figures to be such a favorite over Jason's opening range.
Chase and pass, and Stephen takes the pot.
Jason gives it up. The re-raise gets through for self-confessed satellite junkie, Steve Chidick.
Yeah, I mean, if it had been Mazzia with ace-queen, I think it would have been a bad play for him to re-raise in that spot against Jason, who has so many chips. But with Chidwick's stack size, perfect.
Blinds now 5 and 10,000.
1,000, 5,000, 10,000 on the blinds.
Here we see chip leader Daniele Mazzia throwing in those yellow chips worth 5,000 each.
From Daniele.
Pocket eights, 27,000 to play.
27,000.
Strothman taking his time, giving nothing away. Stone-faced is the expression I'd use, Greg.
That's fine. That's an accurate description of it. Poker-faced is the standard terminology, but it gets boring just to say poker-face over and over.
Stephen re-raise all in.
Should it getting busy again? Another all-in.
Well, this one's not so obvious. There's such a big difference between ace-queen and ace-seven. This one's not so obvious, and for this raise to be correct, it would really be telling us that Mazzia is playing too many hands.
Thing is, we've seen Mazzia play a very aggressive game. He might not want to give up the pocket eights. He's chip leader.
Pass.
No, on this occasion, he thinks better of it. Two in a row for Stephen Chidick.
Well, being super aggressive works great until it doesn't work.
Meanwhile, on the outer tables, it's another hand involving Jonas Melander. He's got ace-eight, but Sebastian Ruthenberg's got the aces. And it's Melander who's all in here.
Well, aces is a pretty huge favorite here. We're talking like 20-1 favorite. Oh, not 20-1 anymore.
Straight draw, a seven or a queen for the straight, a queen on the river.
Wow, that's pretty unlucky.
Ruthenberg taking it remarkably well. Little shrug of the shoulders.
Well, for Alan pre-flop, that's about as unlucky as you can get.
Ace is cracked by ace eight. Doesn't just happen online. Melander's still in. He'll double up through Ruthenberg.
Steven will start us off.
Meanwhile, back on our feature table, action on Stephen Chidiock, looking to make it three in a row, Greg.
Are you a Star Trek fan of Data? You remember Data from the new Star Trek? They got the little button on his neck, you can turn him off. I think Stephen Chidiock has a button on his neck, and they push it and become super aggressive, and someone has touched his button.
To Mikhail.
I think that's what's happened here, because Queen Jack offsuit under the gun, that's a pretty aggressive play.
I'm old school me, prefer Kirk, Spock, and McCoy. Notice that Michael Kiner's just gone out in 25th place. What is the strategy now, Greg? What are these guys thinking about as we get towards the final table?
Well, what they should be thinking about is accumulating chips. They're in the money. But the pay raises from coming in 24th place, 20th, 15th, 10th, those aren't very significant. But once you get to the top three spots, you're going to make so much more money. You should be trying to accumulate chips right now so you can get to one of those top three spots.
And that's exactly what Steve Chidiock's thinking about as he takes another one down. Out on the floor, there's an all-in. It's Salvatore Penge from Italy. He's got a small pocket pair. He's been called by Sebastian Ruthenberg with two overcards. Ruthenberg is the player who needs to hit. It doesn't happen.
Yes.
And Penge will double up.
Yes.
Ruthenberg hemorrhaging chips right now.
Yeah, sometimes you play perfect and it just happens.
So back to our feature table. Cards in the air once again.
Jason will start us off under the gun.
Couple of empty seats now at our feature table playing six-handed poker.
See, Jason Mercier can fold a hand.
There we go, we've finally proven it.
And Matsia as well. They are the two table captains at the moment. Folded to Steve Chidiock on the button. He'll pass, so it's blind on blind.
In the small blind.
Someone wants to push that aggressive button on his neck again. It's turned off.
Jose Ortega, King 10 off suit.
A lot of aggressive players raise any two cards on the button. But this is definitely a hand you got to play from the small blind. No one's raised yet.
He's going to raise 20,000 more to make it 30,000 straight.
Yep, standard play with that hand in this position.
20,000 more for Mikhail Lundell, sitting in the big blind. He's got a pair.
Well, he's definitely not folding this hand. The only question is whether he's going to call and trap or if he's going to just, like, shove in right now. Given the size of the stacks, I think it's either call or shove.
Race.
It's announced raise.
Yep, that's pretty standard too. You should probably re-raise with this hand most of the time. If the stacks are deeper, I'd be more inclined to flat call.
He's made it 80,000 straight, raised it 50,000 more.
Yeah, see, I would have just shoved it all in here. You're going to make Ortega put half his chips in. And at that point, you know, you're really vulnerable to something like a stop and go play. You know, what's he going to do when the flop comes, like ace-queen-three, you know, and Ortega shoves in?
Vazquez makes the call. We're going to see a flop.
Ortega elects to call.
Yeah, see, if I'm Ortega, I'm making that call just to do the stop. In other words, I am going to shove this flop no matter what comes.
Right. Oh, well, he's hit top pair. It's a set of nines for Lundell.
Vazquez check.
See, and that's the one time you don't have to shove when you hit something really huge on the flop.
That's enough to put Ortega all in.
And he's obviously doing it.
Miguel bets.
Ortega sees the bad news. He's drawing incredibly thin. And the crowd are going to be so upset by this because he's the last local boy left in the tournament. He's the last Spanish player remaining.
Yeah. See, the problem, though, with Lundell's play there is it changed his flop just a little bit, make it 10-8 deuce. Now what does he do? He's going to still have to get it all in, and he's now way behind on the flop.
Well, the ace of clubs means it's over on the turn.
Ace of clubs.
Benito.
What?
Now the river.
Yeah, I know. Thank you, man.
I know, but
Lundell didn't realize that. It's over. Relax. Sit down. Take the chips. And we say goodbye to the last Spanish player remaining in the tournament, Jose Vazquez Ortega, finishing in 24th place, collecting €24,700. So we know, Greg, that whatever happens now over the course of this tournament, the trophy, the money, the title will not be staying in Barcelona. But will it be going back to Sweden with this guy?
sponsored by PokerStars.com.
Welcome back to Barcelona and the first event of EPT Season 5. German shooting star Sebastian Ruthenberg had been having a hard time of it, his chips really up and down, but he's looking happier now after just doubling up. Swedish TV star Mikael Lundell is used to the cameras and making waves on the TV table now, but Alessandro Longobardi, not so happy. He's our latest casualty. 22 remain.
Seven players at our feature table, including a couple of new guys just taking their seats. Martin Nielsen is from Denmark, but currently lives in London.
Yes, okay.
Plus, we have a Dutch player. This is Kees Alblas.
And I'm happy to see some players who aren't like 18, 19, and 20 years old. The young guys are so dominating the tournament poker scene in the last couple of years. It's nice to see some guys that are a little closer to my generation.
I'm going to start with Daniele under the gun.
Action on Daniele Mazzia. He will fold. Malte Strothman. Also folding.
He's going to pass around to Martin.
He didn't read the Danish law. If you're a Danish poker player, you're new to the table, you must raise the first hand.
Or maybe he knew that Alblas had a decent hand.
Raise.
From the cutoff, one off the button, raising with the ace queen to 32,000.
So the Dutch don't have that same reputation, so he's supposed to have a real hand here.
And luckily, Lundell has him dominated with ace king. Just going to double check. Yes, it is ace king of clubs.
A very unique style in Lundell. It's going to be a tough spot for Mr. Alblas here because, you know, he's new to the table. He doesn't necessarily know Lundell at all. He may have never seen him before in his life. He doesn't know what his style is. He doesn't know if this re-raise has to be a big hand, if it could be junk. It's going to be hard to figure out. And he might just go broke here with ace-queen, one hand at the feature table.
Call.
Case says call. We're going to see a flop on this pot.
He's committed most of his stack here, Greg.
Yeah, again, I'm not thrilled with Lundell's raise size because his opponent, he's put in 50, 60% of his opponent's chips, and at that point, you frequently just put it all in instead.
Well, on that flop, all the money's going in now.
Well, yeah, given these two hands, all the money was going to go in no matter how either of them played it pre-flop.
So is Case.
Lundell says all in. Alblas says I'm all in. His last 102,000, and he will see that he's outkicked and will need to hit a queen on the turn or river.
Yes, I think Keys is now wishing he had not made it to our feature table. He would have preferred some other situation than this one. Can he get lucky, though? Not on the turn.
Let's see if he gets lucky on the river. There are three queens in the deck which could help him.
No other cards will work, though. Only a queen.
And Lundell will be delighted to see that king on the river.
Let's have a hand for Case. He's going to finish in 22nd place.
So, Keys eliminated from the tournament. One hand on TV. Not a hand he wants to remember.
No, probably not. I mean, he really didn't do anything wrong this hand. It was just unfortunate that he gets ace queen in late position in the big blind, or the small blind, I mean, as ace king. Oh, well. That's poker, as they say.
And he may have just won the hand, but Lundell never looks particularly happy.
We're down to 21 players. That's three tables of seven, and we need another player at our table. It's Davide Katai, who was chip leader at the start of the day. Our current chip leader now is German Dren Ukella with 700,000 chips.
Back at our feature table, Martin Nielsen's in the small blind. We have a new player, Davide Katai, in the big blind.
Former chip leader, now not quite as stratospheric
Stevens
as he was.
He'll pass.
Davide, of course, went deep in this event last year and had success at the World Series of Poker over the summer.
Yeah, he's definitely been making a name for himself on the tournament trail over the last year or so.
Mikael,
as is this guy, Jason Mercier, who is going to raise
Jason
with the King
raise,
10,
making a huge name for himself in the last year or two. Definitely on everyone's radar nowadays.
Daniele Mazzia has got a lot of chips, and I think he's about to get creative with them.
Very creative here. I almost try to make it a rule of thumb that if I'm going to get creative with these kind of hands, they have to be suited. And part of the reason for that is just that it's cutting down on the number of hands like this that I play.
There's the re-raise.
Can you re-raise?
Oh, and there's a real hand. Malte Strothman with ace-king.
So 67,000 now, it's 40,000 chip raise.
A huge stack.
Now, this is probably an automatic all-in for him.
Yep. There we go.
Malte re-raise, all-in.
That was pretty much an automatic play there. It's like Jason's raising pretty light. You know he can have lots of hands. Matsi is a good enough player to recognize that, and he doesn't have to have a top hand.
Well, the blinds both fold. Mercia folds, and Matsi is now trying to work out how much he's already put in, how much is in the middle, how much it'll be for him to call here.
Yeah, and he might be pretty much pot committed here.
He's going to be pretty embarrassed to turn over the 9-7 off suit.
Well, that's the problem with getting creative with these hands, is that sometimes you find yourself in a spot just like this. You know, all of a sudden, you thought you were going to put in X, and you have to put in 3X, you know, and you know you don't have the best hand, and you know you're going to look like an idiot even if you get lucky and win.
He's made the call. He shows the garbage hand. Strothman's delighted, but there's 9 and his 7 alive, and we've seen a couple of kings folded.
Well, see, I'm not too delighted when I'm all in for my tournament life, and 36% of the time I'm going to go home, especially when I've got such a big hand as ace-king. He'd be much, much, much better off if he'd run into an ace-queen here. He'd have been a significantly bigger favorite.
And he's hit his 7,
and just like that, boom, now you're way behind.
7 of hearts, queen of diamonds.
I was
going to need an ace or a king.
Looking for an ace, and we know there's only one king left in the deck.
Turn is the 5.
He's got a hit on the river, or we say goodbye to Malte Strothman. And the German player is gone. 7s and deuces. Or win the hand for Daniela Matsia.
And Matsia gave him that little look, kind of like, oh, sorry, you know, that embarrassed shrug of the shoulders.
Next time, maybe easier.
And Mercia's thinking, is that the kind of respect you have for my raises, that you'll come over the top of me with 9-7?
Well, sometimes you don't want respect, you know, because sometimes too much respect means not enough chips.
Yeah, good play.
Strothman out in 21st place then, and 4 more quickly followed, all taking home 24,700 euros.
See you next time. Next live.
And that leaves us with 16, and top of the tree is Dren Ukella with 741,000 in chips. There's a strong Scandinavian representation at the top of the table as well, and Mercier is still looking for his second EPT title. Last Englishman standing, online qualifying supremo, Stephen Chidwick. But really needing the help is Italian Claudio Cecchi. He'll be looking for a double up. These 16 are the cream of the crop. They've made it to the final stages here at EPT Barcelona. It's time for a redraw here, which means that we'll have a new feature table for you next time. Join us then when we play down to our final 8 and find out who will be in with a shot for the nearly 1.4 million euro top prize. We'll see you next time. Don't miss it.
Sponsored by PokerStars.com.